In this video, we're looking at yet a few more examples of solving linear programming problems geometrically. And the first one is quite different from anything we've seen before. In this example, we're stocking a lake with fish, and we're not trying to maximize profit. We're not trying to minimize cost. What we're doing is trying to maximize the weight of the fish, which can be supported by the foods that are available in the lake. There are two foods, A and B, which are found in the lake. We know how much of each type food is required by the trout and how much of each type food is required by the salmon. We know how much food is of each type is available daily in the lake. The trout weigh 2 pounds, the salmon weigh 4 pounds, and the question is how many of each type fish should we put in the lake? So we'll let X represent the number of trout and Y the number of salmon that are used to stock the lake. Since the trout weigh 2 pounds each and the salmon weigh 4 pounds each, the total weight of the fish in the lake will be 2x plus 4y. The constraints look like this. With food A, since the trout require 2 units of food A and the salmon require 1 unit of food A and there's 500 units of food A available, the limited amount of food A in the lake causes us to have what's shown here as the food A constraint. The food B constraint is similar. Of course, you need to go back and look at the word problem in order to pull out these numbers. And we have the non-negative constraints as usual. The food A constraint line is the green line shown here. And the solution region is the points on or to the left of the green line. The food B constraint line is the second green line shown here, with the solution region being to the side that the second blue arrow points at. Of course, the non-negative constraints put us in the first quadrant. So if you look at the solution region for each of the two inequalities, the part of that that lies in the first quadrant would be this portion of the first quadrant that I'm pointing to. The yellow region. The corner points, there are 4 of them. There's the origin, 1 on the y-axis, 1 on the x-axis, and the point where the two equations that go with these two lines cross. If you use the standard techniques that we know about in order to find the coordinates of these 4 corner points, they are as shown here. Obviously, not putting any fish in the lake is not going to be the way to maximize the weight. One of the strategies corresponds to stocking the lake only with trout. One of the strategies, stocking only with salmon, in which case you can put in 300. And it appears that the optimal corner point is the one that uses some of both, 120 trout and 260 salmon, which would give you a total weight of fish supported in the lake to be 1,280 pounds, and yet would still meet the constraints of not exceeding the food supply shown. The 250, 0 is the corner point shown here. 0, 300 is the corner point on the y-axis. And the optimal corner point in this case is the one where these two green lines intersect. Don't be tempted to assume that that's automatically going to be the optimal corner point. You have no way of knowing that until you check all the corner points and see what the weight would be associated with each one. But in this case, as indicated, it is the 1,280 pounds of fish distributed among 120 trout and 260 salmon that gives you the optimal stocking strategy. The second example is that of a cabinet maker. The cabinet maker makes two products, bookcases and glass door cabinets. There's a known amount of lumber available. We know how much wood it takes and how much labor it takes to make each of the two items, the bookcase or the glass door cabinet. We know how much labor is available. There's a limit on glass doors, which limits the number of cabinets that can be made. And we know how profitable it is to make a cabinet or to make a bookcase. So the question is, how many of each item should be made in order to achieve a maximum profit? What would that profit be? And will there be any leftovers, any leftover wood or any unused labor capacity or any glass doors that are not used? So we commence as usual by naming our variables in the problem. X will represent the number of cabinets we're going to make, Y the number of bookcases. The profit function, if you go back and look at the word problem, will be P equals 20X plus 15Y, simply because the profit is $20 for each cabinet and $15 for each bookcase. The wood constraint is that the amount of wood used on cabinets plus the amount of wood used on bookcases cannot exceed the 18,000 units of wood that were available. In this example, the units of wood were measured in board feet, so we're talking about 18,000 board feet here. The time constraint is in hours, based on how much time it takes to make a cabinet, how much time it takes to make a bookcase, and the total number of hours of labor time available. The glass door constraint is limited simply by the fact that there are only that many glass doors available, and every glass door cabinet takes one. And finally, our non-negative constraints. So we graph all the constraints, the wood constraint, the time constraint, the glass door constraint, which is a vertical line because it only involves the variable x, and our non-negative constraints, and we wind up with the yellow region shown in the first quadrant. So apparently we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 corner points that we need to check in order to see where the maximum profit would come from. One of the corner points will be the origin, which obviously is not going to give us the maximum profit. It produces no profit at all. If we don't do anything, there's no profit. Make zero cabinets or zero bookcases is not helpful. One of the corner points corresponds to making only bookcases. We can make no cabinets and 250 bookcases for a profit of $3,750. One of the corner points corresponds to a strategy of making only the cabinets. We can make 200 cabinets and no bookcases for a profit of $4,000. One of our corner points corresponds to a strategy of making 132 cabinets and 162 bookcases for a total profit of $5,070. Now, remember, to find these coordinates, you don't just try to look at the graph. You don't try to do it just by looking at the graph. You have to go off and solve the pair of equations, and you know those equations because you know where they came from. Solve that system of equations using whatever method you like. And then finally, the bottom listed corner point, 200 cabinets and 60 bookcases, would correspond to this corner point right here, and would yield a profit of $4,900. So apparently the most profitable strategy is the next to bottom one, isn't it? A strategy of making 132 cabinets and 162 bookcases for a total profit of $5,070. Now remember, we were asked about leftovers. Are there any leftovers? The optimal strategy is the one corresponding to this corner point. This corner point lies on the wood constraint line, doesn't it? So it satisfies the equation 75x plus 50y equals 18,000, which means if we follow that strategy, we're using 18,000 board feet of lumber, which means we don't have any leftover lumber. And this optimal corner point is also on the time constraint line. So the coordinates satisfy the equation 2x plus 3y equals 750, which means we're using all 750 hours of our available labor. However, this corner point does not lie on the glass door constraint line, which means X is not equal to 200. We're not using all 200 of the available glass doors. In fact, for that corner point, we're only using 132 glass doors because we're making 132 glass door cabinets. So, in fact, there would be, since there are 200 available, if we're only making 132 cabinets using 132 glass doors, that means we would actually have, what is that, 68? 68 of the glass doors would be left over. So, yes, there are leftovers, and the leftover in this particular example is 68 leftover glass doors that are not used. Now, let's suppose because of consumer demand, bookcases become more profitable, dramatically so. Suppose the profit on bookcases changes from $15 per bookcase to $45 per bookcase because they're in great demand. How does that change our solution? The key thing to realize is that it doesn't change anything with regard to what the constraints are. All we're talking about is a change in the profit function. And remember, you don't even deal with the profit function until you've already found all your corner points. So the only thing we have to recalculate in order to do this slightly different version of the problem, we'll still have the same corner points. We simply have to recalculate the profit associated with each corner point. The profit function now being 20x plus 45y rather than 20x plus 15y. And if you go through and calculate the profit for each corner point with this new profit function, you see that the situation has changed and that now the most profitable strategy is the second one in the list, which says make no cabinets at all, make only bookcases, in which case you can make 250 of them, and your profit will be $11,250. So the optimal strategy now corresponds to the corner point way up here. And that really isn't too surprising, is it? If bookcases have become extremely profitable to make, then it shouldn't be terribly surprising that in this scenario, the optimal strategy would be to drop the cabinet making business altogether and put all your effort into making bookcases. So in summary, with the original profit function, the optimal strategy was the next to bottom one. With the change in the profitability of the bookcases, the optimal strategy switches to a strategy of making no cabinets whatsoever.